Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub. Welcome to part two of our year-end L'Chaim Roundtable as we continue our retrospective of the year 2016 in terms of the events and people of importance to Jewish life and the Jewish community. And once again, I'm joined by this wonderful panel of guests who offer thoughtful and insightful perspectives as they analyze the people, issues, and events that are shaping the Jewish future. Let me reintroduce them to you. You know them very well. Stephen Bayme is the director of the Contemporary Life Department of the American Jewish Committee and the AJC's Koppelman Institute on American Jewish-Israeli Relations. Rabbi Eric Yoffie is President Emeritus of the Union for Reform Judaism and is a columnist for Haaretz, a frequent guest speaker and scholar in residence in communities across America. Betty Ehrenberg is the Executive Director of the World Jewish Congress of North America. And Thane Rosenbaum is a Distinguished Fellow at NYU Law School. He's also the Director of the Forum on Law, Culture, and Society. He's an award-winning essayist, best-selling author, whose latest novel is entitled How Sweet It Is, a novel about Jewish life in Miami of the 1970s, 1972. It is wonderful to have you back as we continue our discussion. If you are with us for part one, you know I asked all four of my guests what was the most important Jewish event of 2016, and three of them said the election of Donald Trump. So on our last program, we spent the entire program talking about Donald Trump and David Friedman, and what does it mean for the American Jewish community and for Israel that Donald Trump is now president-elect and will be the president on January 20th of 2017. We're not talking anymore about Trump. We're talking about anything else that you think was important in the year 2016. When I asked, by the way, Betty, you said that for you, the most important event of 2016 was the passing of Elie Wiesel. Of course, we lost Elie Wiesel and Shimon Peres. We lost many people, many wonderful people in 2016, but two giants, Shimon Peres and Elie Wiesel. But you said that for you, his passing was the most important event of the year. Why?
Because I think it has repercussions for the young generation. The young generation of Jews that I meet very often doesn't feel as close to Israel as I wish they would, doesn't feel as close to the Holocaust as I wish they would in terms of understanding the lessons and the profound impact it had on Jewish families and the Jewish diaspora in general, the Jewish demographics. And we did talk a little bit in the last session about Bernie Sanders and Jews who to really, as far as I'm concerned, don't come on the side of Israel as much as I think they should. And I think Elie Wiesel was primarily an educator, a professor at Boston University, had so many students, and I think the loss for the knowledge and transmission of Jewish history, and not only the moral exemplar that he was, I think is great.
Mm-hmm. As you hear Betty talk about Elie Wiesel, any other thought you want to add?
Well, there's certainly a void. I think the word I used, colossal, at the time, but it is a void that has not and may never be filled. I mean, he was the world's best-known Jew, and he was known not as an athlete or as an actor. You know, this isn't like Jewish geography. You know, Barbara Streisand is Jewish, Betty Bacall or Lauren Bacall. This was a person who was a kind of moral voice. You know, as I said, in Europe, he was known much better, known as a novelist. Here, he was very often discounted and devalued as a writer. But his presence, you remember, this is the man who, you know, gave a tour of, you know, Buchenwald for Obama and Merkel. This is the person who, you know, was the world's leading, most well-known survivor, and a person who won a Nobel Peace Prize on behalf of a number of things that had important things going to do related to the Jewish world, including mm-hmm. the freedom of Soviet Jewry. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure that kind of presence can be filled, and certainly hasn't been and may never be. But he was a voice of moral conviction and conscience, and he, he was on Oprah. You know, there wasn't anything that he wasn't, and I just think that you know, everyone felt an attachment, a connection to him by reading Night, and I think the last thing I want to say about that, and that, similar to what we said when we talked about Perez, that it's as if it's the end of an era, a generation, like you had said about Perez, that, you know, he was a Mount Rushmore figure, and that he was the last of that generation. Mm-hmm. And I think that's true of Wiesel, of the survivor generation. We always knew this day would come, mm-hmm. that the world would be without survivors, but the passing of Wiesel really is the, you know, the signature blow, that the Holocaust, I wouldn't say obsession, but the world's awareness of the Holocaust as they understood it through Wiesel, that has already been on the declining slope of that. But with Wiesel's death, it's certainly more finite. Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised at how much I miss him. And I feel the world is less safe because he's not here. And
Well, you know him for years.
I did, and he was very, very good to me and very good to first L'Chaim and then to JBS. And he was very encouraging of me, and he said he just kept saying to me, you've got to write, and I never did while he was alive, and I miss him very much, and I was very glad that you said that of all the events in 2016, his passing may have been the most momentous, and I don't know if all of world Jewry understands what we lose because we don't have Elie Wiesel speaking for us. And he was also fabulous with Midrash, what he called legends, and his ability to explain what the Jewish tradition, the insights of the Jewish tradition and the loveliness of it was wonderful. And he has this book, Messengers of God, which when people say to me, what should I read? I say, read Messengers of God. It's his take on many of the stories of the Tanakh, first the Torah, and some other stories as well, and all the Midrash, which are all classical Midrash that he was able to weave into stories that were, they changed my life and created my rabbinate.
May I ask you something
yeah.
about this? Would you say that in the same spirit in which you said Perez was, you know, the last of that generation, would you have said that Wiesel's loss should have struck the Jewish community in the loss of a Gandhi, a loss of a Martin Luther King? Should it have had that kind of impact?
I think so, and also something you said is very important. I worry about what's going to happen to the Shoah when there are no living survivors. When you think of that, does that concern you at all, or you think you don't worry that ultimately the Shoah has a power of its own? And
well, look, first of all, we are living in the post-Ofra rendition. In other words, a work by Wiesel, probably his earliest work, you know, became literally all over the map, and it is the story of the Holocaust, One Long Night.
Yes.
Personally, I was much more influenced, even going back in high school, by Gates of the Forest.
Me too.
Which I think has a tremendous message for Jews today, namely that it's a dialogue between Gregor, the survivor, if you will, and Gabriel, sort of this angelic figure, and it's about reversing roles. You know, God has become man has become God. The message, in effect, is that you can't expect a thunderbolt from heaven to change the course of history, but it's up to us to do so. The closing scene, I think, is remarkable, and it's a fundamental message to American Jewry, that Gregor, the survivor, comes to New York, and he wanders into a Hasidic shtetl, and he says, Rabbi, how can you pray after all that's happened? And the rabbi says, how can you not pray after all that's happened? That is a fundamentally searing message from Wiesel to contemporary Jews, that we have all sorts of questions about why we're continuing with this entire business, but our covenant, if you will, our imperative, is that we do continue with this entire business. Mm-hmm. Will Wiesel as a personality be forfeited? Yeah, he was a colossus. He was all over the airwaves. He was someone you thousands of people attended his lectures, hundreds of students, probably thousands of students as well. But to have the kind of legacy of the works that he wrote, I think will only grow in importance over the years. I would hope the day would come when it's not Night that's his signature work, but rather something like Gates of the Forest, which is a fundamentally powerful message of keeping up with this Jewish enterprise. Mm-hmm.
By the way, did you know Shimon Peres by any chance?
I did know. I mean, Wiesel I knew a bit.
Yep.
Peres I knew quite well. Peres taught a lesson of hope. And, you know, he was an uneven politician, sometimes good, mostly not. But throughout his long career, and he's not given credit for being realistic enough, because he was quite realistic, in fact, and especially if you spoke to him one-on-one. But ultimately, he believed that peace was possible no matter how far away it might be.
Yes.
And he taught the lesson that our enemies are our enemies, but they are people. And not every Palestinian is a Nazi. Not every Palestinian is a terrorist. And if they're not ready for peace now, they will be ready for peace. And it's our responsibility to help them make that connection. And even when things went badly, as they often did, he hammered home over and over again this message that peace is possible, if not now, on the horizon.
Beautiful, beautiful.
It was hugely important, and we will miss somebody who was able to articulate that message.
Yes.
And give it meaning in his life.
He became, by the way, much more beloved at the end of his life.
It's extraordinary what happened at the end of his life. And he was, you know, a divisive figure for much of his life. But, I mean, having said that, in the last decade, he became beloved by both right and left.
Yes.
Becoming president, when he became president, turned out to be hugely important. The presidency had been devalued by what had come before. We don't need to talk about that. He restored sort of dignity to the office of the presidency. But to the extent that Israel could be united in a very divisive time, he united it. And people on the right admired him as much as people on the left. And the last word about Peres is whenever you met, first of all, he was accessible, as many people are not. I mean, no matter how important he was, he never sort of set himself apart. If you wanted to sit with him, you could sit with him. But it was extraordinary. You never sat with Shimon Peres when he didn't tell you what he was reading. And he didn't do it in a self-important way. He didn't do it in a pretentious way. He would talk about what he'd been reading last night. That was what he'd been reading last night. Apparently, he never went to sleep. And usually political books that dealt with how we can improve the society in which we live. This was a person who took learning seriously and was always sharing ideas with others in the hope he would stimulate them, and in turn they would stimulate him.
For about 7 years, I would take about 10 or 12 university presidents to Israel for a week-long seminar, get to know Israeli society. Literally 7 out of 7 times, we met with Shimon Peres, and here were people, finest universities in the country, no lack of opportunities to meet dignitaries, welcome presidents and vice presidents onto their campuses. They were invariably wowed by this man as a walking advertisement, if you will, a poster boy for this is what a Jewish state is all about. I would add, by the way, that as a very secular Israeli politician, he had a very strong command of Judaic heritage and tradition. Mm-hmm. And that, again, was a message that we need to hear much more of. Mm-hmm. So I don't think of any personality that would fill that role, but I certainly see Israel as ultimately embodying that vision of what a Jewish state means to the rest of the world.
Lovely.
My impression of him that lingers really is mostly of the man in the 1950s who went to France, and when France was still our friend, and the friend of Israel, and procured what everybody knows about, but Israel can really not say, and has to do with its nuclear capability in Dimona. France was our friend at the time, the Mirage planes, all of that. But yet when it came to a real basic difference between Israel and France, and it wasn't just a matter of timing or a matter of what Israel, when Israel might do something that she wanted to do, when there was a basic understanding between France and Israel, it was the Six-Day War, before the Six-Day War. Lyndon Johnson and Levi Eshkol had differences over what Israel might do, when it might do it. But Charles de Gaulle told Israel, if you do this, don't do this, but if you do this, then we no longer have a relationship. And Charles de Gaulle made good on that. So what I was trying to say about conviction, loving Israel rather, supporting Israel out of conviction rather of convenience, I mean, we see today that even the repercussions of that, the EU, the France and Europe and the European Union today is friends with Israel out of convenience and not out of the conviction that the United States has always had. And I think we were very fortunate that Shimon Peres took advantage of the timing and did what he did to help secure Israel in a very monumental way. To the last days, from what I learned when I was serving at the Israeli consulate, Shimon Peres's voice was highly esteemed in the security, in the defense department of Israel. Decisions still were run by him, even till very, very late. And I was deeply impressed by that.
Nice. Anything you want to add or no?
Yeah, I would like to add that, and I think I said this when we were on the program after his death, which I think is important not to have mentioned again, is that his passing also represents a shift away from that generation of Polish, East European, Russian Jewry that founded this country. That world, you know, for decades, depended on this sort of Ashkenazi sensibility. And today, I mean, today we think about the Russian Jews, and we think about the Ethiopian Jews, and we think about people making Aliyah, including new French wave of French Jewry. But Israel was largely founded after the Holocaust from the likes of guys like Shimon Peres and his parents, Polish Yiddish speakers, shtetl dwellers, people that came from the Pale of Settlement and from Poland. And you know, it was so highly identified with the nation building of Israel, and I think that's going to be lost. Mm-hmm. It'll be part of the history books, but it won't be part of the ethos. I mean, you know, what we're going to know now is that, you know, Israel, Tel Aviv now is being known for having great French restaurants, but it's because of this exodus, not that first exodus.
Mm-hmm. All right, so what's the next most important event for you in 2016? You know, I mentioned a few in the open of the program. One, are there any that come to your mind? Is there something else in addition to President Trump being elected and Donald Trump being elected and the death of Elie Wiesel? What's next for you?
An event that probably is underrated, but I think has enormous importance symbolically and in terms of the Jewish future, is the collapse of the compromise over the Western Wall. Now, when I say it's of limited significance tangibly, what I mean by that is that I'm not sure that this is an issue that has enormous repercussions in terms of Israeli society, Israel-diaspora relations. It has aspects of that. But the real point here is that you had a test case of the will of American Jewry was very, very clear. The will of the Orthodox parties in Israel was directly opposite. A promise was made that essentially said we will allocate a compromise that there will be equal access to different services at the Western Wall. The failure of that compromise because of internal Israeli politics, symbolically, aside from the fact the issue itself has some tangible significance, but not overriding, that has enormous symbolic significance over what do we mean by the future of a Jewish state. Mm-hmm. During the course, I think, might have been December of 2015, so it might go back a bit, 1 month before our deadline, the Pew Report issued its Israel's Religiously Divided Society. What it showed was a fundamental conflict of something like 89% of ultra-Orthodox or Haredi Jews and 68% of national religious felt that if it was a conflict between halakha and democracy, halakha should triumph. Now, obviously, non-Orthodox Israelis feel just the opposite, and American Jews largely would identify with that position. I'm depressed over the failure of that compromise, not only because of the issue itself, which I think, again, has some significance but limited significance, but it's a larger question of what do we mean by our vision of a Jewish state, and to what extent will that Jewish state be the embodiment of the collective will of the Jewish people? The Western Wall was a test case of that, and it failed miserably.
You know this issue intimately. How do you feel about the fact that there was a compromise? There was going to be a third section of the wall, egalitarian, Robinson's Arch, and it fell apart.
I think, Steve, I identify with his comments. I think he perhaps understated the importance. It was a great tragedy. It was a great tragedy. 3 years were spent in resolving this issue. And it had to do with some specific religious concerns that we needn't enter into. They were important, although best not to overstate them. It had to do with the willingness of all sides to compromise. The ultimate deal was not a great deal from our perspective as Reform Jews. It wasn't a great deal for the other side either. Ultimately, a good compromise
That's
is
a
one
compromise,
in which...
Yes.
In which
I do want to just make sure everybody understands. If you go to Jerusalem and you stand at the Western Wall, and you want to pray at the Western Wall, it is basically considered to be an Orthodox synagogue with a machitza, a dividing line between the men's section and the women's section. There's a screen that separates men and women. And men and women cannot stand together in prayer at the Western Wall. And because it's an Orthodox synagogue where the tradition of Orthodoxy is maintained, in the women's section, women are not permitted to do certain things that they might do in an egalitarian service. They're not allowed, for example, to read from the Torah. And the idea was, the compromise that both Steve and Eric have referred to, is there was an idea that there should be a compromised third section of the wall, not at the area where the famous picture which you see under the Dome of the Rock, but around the corner. It's the same wall, but it's further down. There's a piece of it where there used to be an arch. It was identified by a man named Robinson, so it's called Robinson's Arch. And Natan Sharansky had the idea that we should create another esplanade there where ultimately people who wanted to be involved in an egalitarian service or women wanted to do certain things that they were not permitted to do at the Orthodox section of the wall, that's where that would be done, and it would be ultimately created with the same kind of look and feel and elegance of the rest of the wall. And it looked like that was a compromise that had been worked out. Everybody agreed, and as Eric said, everybody wished it had gone further or not gone at all. That's called a compromise. And people like Anat Hoffman, Women of the Wall, members of the Reform Movement here in America, members of the Conservative Movement, were pushing very hard for a place where American Jews who visited Israel, or for that matter, Israelis who did not want to be limited to Orthodoxy, could also find expression at what is the most historic spot in the Jewish world. And that was a deal that was worked out over a period of years, as Eric says. And Natan Sharansky, as head of the Jewish Agency, spearheaded some kind of compromise.
And it should be said, first of all, mainstream American Orthodoxy ultimately supported this deal. They saw it as imperfect in some ways, but a way to resolve a difficult problem. And also, it was going to be an instrument whereby the Prime Minister of Israel was going to assert himself as someone who is, in many ways, the leader of the Jewish people and sort of reestablish what had been somewhat frayed credentials, certainly with the non-Orthodox element of the American Jewish public, because Prime Minister Netanyahu had been behind this, had initially called upon Sharansky, and had given assurance after assurance that it would happen. And with all of these things, it then collapsed because the ultra-Orthodox parties, which had initially said, well, they weren't going to endorse it, but they would go along. They wouldn't invoke their right as members of the coalition to cancel the deal. And then for a variety of reasons, there are different explanations, the Orthodox parties ultimately did just that. They said, this provides a certain element of legitimacy to the non-Orthodox movement. We can't possibly go along. They threatened to leave the coalition. And the deal, in essence, is dead, although the prime minister refuses to say that it's dead. Now, I should note that in my movement, part of the advantage of this situation is it has mobilized the non-Orthodox world in a way that no other issue has since the founding of the State of Israel. And those of us concerned about religious pluralism have found, to some extent to our surprise, that we have more interest in this matter, more support on this matter, more activity on this matter than we've ever had before. So from that perspective, there's...
Why do you think that is?
I think it has to do with a variety of things. I think it has to do with, first of all, awareness about Jewish pluralism has grown over the decades. It was a rather minor issue. When we were building a Jewish state, it wasn't our central concern. The Orthodox rabbinate was more moderate in its outlook. Certainly until the 1980s. You have issues such as technology, which are very, very important here. In other words, there was a moment when the women of the wall being dragged away by the police was on social media and was on YouTube, and it created images that people couldn't possibly have imagined before. That was a huge factor. And I mentioned finally the interest of the general press in this issue, for whatever reason, we can speculate on that, was also exceedingly important. Michael Oren said, in recounting this, how he had to call the prime minister and tell him that women of the wall had been on the front page of the New York Times or on the first pages of the New York Times more frequently than the Iran issue, and that the prime minister had to do something about it. That's a true story. And it was at that point that the prime minister called for setting up a committee to resolve this. And despite all of this, the ultra-Orthodox parties killed the deal. So where does that leave us? That leaves us in a state of religious warfare, which is not where I would like to be now. Mm-hmm. And I think it's tragic, but having gone down this road, I mean, unfortunately, it's hard to be optimistic here about seeing progress on a whole range of religious issues when, in fact, it's essential for Israel-diaspora relations, central for the state of Israel itself.
Okay, one last question. What's the worst fallout that could occur?
Well, look, the worst fallout is that non-Orthodox Jews will become alienated from Israel. I mean, that's the worst fallout. And what we say in the leadership is, never, ever let that happen.
Good for you.
Never, ever. First of all, our commitment to Israel is unbreakable. And by the way, that's exactly what the most radical religious elements want. They want us to back away from Israel and leave the religious issues to them and leave the religious character of the Jewish state to them. And we say, this is a matter for the Jewish people. And we're a majority element of the Jewish people. But is there a danger in that regard? I would be dishonest if I didn't say that such a danger
okay.
exists.
Does Rick Jacobs take the same position you do?
Basically, yes. I will say that.
Rick, I mean, you were unequivocal.
I was unequivocal, but look, Rick was, I retired just before this happened. This has been an issue for a long time. These specific negotiations have been handled by Rick very skillfully, I must say, and he's been an articulate spokesperson for these concerns.
Can I just say, Eric says it very beautifully, but the one area where I might disagree a bit, when he says the worst scenario would be the alienation of the non-Orthodox Jews. Obviously, that's a terrible scenario, but even worse in terms of an outcome would be the transformation of the Jewish state. In other words, what you're witnessing in terms of the success of those who want to defeat this compromise, they essentially have taken on the message that we can do it. Our numbers are growing. The demographics are on our side. What is our future vision of the Jewish state? Is it that of a Jewish democracy? Or is it that of we are a halachic state which tries to make some room for some democratic norms and values? My fear is that it's the latter. And that when you ask me what the worst possible outcome would be, is I'd say the outcome Eric projects would be absolutely terrible and something that should never happen. But there's an even worse outcome, that the fundamental vision of Israel as a Jewish state and a Jewish democracy, which in my book is non-negotiable, it may very well become negotiable. And this kind of incident is symbolic of that.
Okay. Any comment?
I'm trying to think of how it's possible to bring to Israel the idea that Judaism is not all or nothing. And I think that's really our problem here. There is a big problem in tone. We talked about tone last time as well. I think sometimes some of the most salient personalities that are involved in this issue and make the front page of the New York Times are not the don't exemplify the best way of going about this or about teaching this idea that Judaism is not all or nothing. And therefore, they're not having a lot of success. I don't know what the answer is right now. We hope that Natan Sharansky, who certainly is a unifying personality in Israel, could help with this. So we are, in a sense, back to the drawing board. That's all I can say at this moment.
Do you want anything?
I would just say, given the volatility of that part of the world, Israel should never show itself to exhibit the intolerance that we see under Sharia law in Islam. We should never look, we should always say what we mean, which is that Israel is a liberal democracy that believes in religious pluralism, that has a free press and a functioning rule of law, and that, you know, Arabs and Jews can go watch Lady Gaga perform, and they're sitting right next to homosexuals. And that kind of liberal society, pluralistic liberal society, is Israel's strength in that region of the world. And I think in order to be consistent, we need to showcase Israel in that spirit, in that way.
I think there is a possibility of doing something in a good way. There is an example. They have now in the rabbinic courts the presence of yoatzot halacha, or toanot, which are women legal advisors, halachic Torah advisors, women Torah advisors who will help in matters of divorce and such similar issues. When this first came to the rabbinic courts, there was a hue and cry against it. It was really an automatic kind of pushing away, but slowly, surely, it now exists. So I think there's hope to do something.
I want to make sure no one misunderstands you. You're not suggesting that in general, Israel is not a pluralistic, democratic.
Of course not.
Right.
Yeah.
We are talking about a very narrow area of Jewish life.
Right, but you, the story, the anecdote about Michael Oren is important here. Because whenever Israel shows itself to be intolerant, whenever a woman walks through Jerusalem singing a song and somebody's throwing a rock at her, that's on the front page of the New York Times.
Yes.
That's going to be focused on. They're not going to listen. They don't care about anything else.
Okay.
They're going to focus on that.
Okay. I want to give you just a slightly different perspective, and then anybody can react. Eric is a Reform rabbi. A non-Orthodox rabbi, not only a non-Orthodox rabbi, you have to be part of the club. If you're not part of the club, a certain kind of Orthodox rabbi, your Mesader Kedushin power is non-existent. And many people point out, isn't it ironic that the only place in which two Jews can't choose to be married in any way they want is the state of Israel, and many Israelis now have to go. They used to be to Cyprus, they go to Europe, they go anywhere, America, because otherwise you must be married by an Orthodox rabbi and an ultra-Orthodox rabbi. Okay. At the same time that I know that that's true about me, when I go to Israel, the amount of time that I'm in Israel where that affects me is almost non-existent. The only time it ever applies to me as an American Jew going to Israel is if I go to the Western Wall with my wife and I can't stand with her, or my daughter, I can't stand with her. And by the way, my own attitude is, on a scale of 1 to 10, that for me is a 2. I understand what is going on at the Western Wall. I respect the tradition at the moment that the State of Israel is established. And I've argued for years and years and years for Sharansky's compromise. Just make a third section. By the way, if it were up to me, it would be at the section right under the Dome of the Rock. It shouldn't be around the corner at Robinson's Arch. There should be three sections right there, and you go wherever you want. That's what I believe should happen. I believe that any rabbi, any Jew, any Israeli picks me or Eric or a conservative rabbi, a Reconstructionist rabbi to do their wedding, it should be have as much sanction as an Orthodox rabbi. I don't question that at all. But the amount of impact it has on me is only theoretical. And I say to myself, American Jewry has a perspective on what Jewish pluralism is that Israelis don't have. I talk to Israeli after Israeli who says to me, I'm not going to step foot in an Orthodox synagogue, but if I was going to go to any synagogue, it would be Orthodox. And they nicely say to me, you're not real. Now, I wish they Israeli would understand every movement of Judaism has authenticity, and it's no less real. Orthodox Judaism and Conservative Judaism, Reform Judaism, Reconstructionist Judaism, and there are now multiplicities of Judaism, all have an authenticity. But until Israelis want it to change and they become infuriated with a political process that entrenches what most Israelis will tell me is a corrupt Orthodox rabbinate and an Orthodox system that is corrupt and does nothing good for the overall well-being of the State of Israel, until Israelis want that to change. I am offended by any American Jew who says, if they don't treat me like the synagogue down the block treats me here in Scarsdale or in in Long Island or in Skokie or in Nashville or in Seattle, I don't love the State of Israel. And while Eric says it unequivocally, I have not heard that from every one of your colleagues who leads non-Orthodox Jewish movements. And I've sat with Jewish leaders on L'chaim who say to me, they understand why American Jews may become distant from the State of Israel because there's no Jewish pluralism. I think there should be Jewish pluralism in the State of Israel. I'd like to see it happen. I believe it won't happen until Israelis want it to happen. And in the meantime, I don't want any American Jew to use that as an excuse or a reason to distance themselves from the State of Israel. That's my position. You may now take it apart.
Let me try to take a stab at taking it apart, because there are elements in it, obviously, that are quite true and compelling. There are other elements that, frankly, sadden me a bit.
I saddened you. My opinion.
Somewhat.
My position said you. I don't send you.
No.
My position saddened you. Okay.
There's an age-old distinction between society and state. It goes back to the Tocqueville in the 19th century. If a society chooses to be traditional, a person who tells you, I will never set foot in a synagogue, but the one I would set foot in was the Orthodox
synagogue. You've heard that all the time.
Absolutely.
We've all heard it.
That's a position about society. The issue is that of the state harnessing its coercive power to compel a particular expression of Judaism or a particular Judaic ritual. In other words, if someone tells you, I'm going to get married, I'd rather have the Orthodox rabbi do it because he's the cheapest one in town, or whatever's the equivalent, or he does it faster, or he'll give me the least amount of problems. That's a position that I may not respect, but I say that's a societal position. That's what a free society will give you, that option. But when the state tells you, you must go to the Orthodox rabbi because we don't recognize any other possibility, then the coercive power of the state has been used to impose its view, the view of a rather narrow minority, upon society as a whole. That, to me, is a crisis of democracy versus what is interpreted as being a particular vision of halacha. So that's one area I would disagree with you.
So let's take them one at a time.
Okay, all right, okay. I've got a second one.
Because, again, always saddens me to sadden you.
Okay.
It is a function of Israeli democracy. If you're telling me you respect democracy, then although you may not like it, there is a legitimate democratic parliamentary process in the State of Israel, which Israelis often tell me they hate, but they don't hate enough to change. And this is the process that the State of Israel endorses and embraces. It's a coalition government. And once you have a coalition government, small parties hold a disproportionate power in that coalition government. You may not like it, but it's inappropriate to tell me it is a violation of democratic principles. This is the democracy in action in the state of Israel. You don't like it? Too bad. This is the democratic process in Israel.
Democracy also entails human rights. And I would think one human right is basically the choice of whom one marries and how one marries.
By the way, I agree with you, but Israel doesn't agree with you.
Let me take a crack. It may be a crisis of democracy. To me, it's a crisis of Zionism.
Bowie, I'm not disagreeing with you.
But
I'm only saying I don't want American Jews to use this as a reason to in any way distance themselves from the state of Israel. And I also want to say, and I want any one of the four of you to tell me I'm wrong, any one of us goes to Israel, the amount of time this impacts us is almost zero.
First of all, if we're serious about Zionism, Zionism asserts that the Jewish state is the state of the Jewish people.
Absolutely.
And so I have a right to say to Israelis, all right, you have a variety of political problems. I understand those problems. They're not easy to resolve. But we're always hearing from you about our responsibilities as Jews, about the claw, about the need for the Jewish people everywhere to identify with this state. So let's understand what your responsibilities are. I have responsibility to you. You have responsibility to me. And while you may relate to my advice on, say, security issues with reservations, because you say this is an immediate issue of life and death, when it comes to the broader issues of the Jewish people and the identification of Jews elsewhere with the Jewish state, you can't, on the one hand, push me away, and then on the other hand, assert that somehow issues of Jewish loyalty and identification come into play. So I have every right to bring that up, and I should and I must, and I'm not overly, convinced by what you're saying.
Let's take one at a time. What have I said that suggests any disagreement? What have I said in any way that would make you say to me, the problem is, I don't want Israel to change.
But you lack a sense of urgency here, and perhaps a sense of understanding. In other words, in an era in which everything that everybody says is all over the media every day, and in an era in which cabinet members of the current government, I could give you a whole list, a dozen comments made over the course of this year that we're talking about, that were outrageously insulting to non-Orthodox Jews by people who sit in the government.
Right.
That creates a certain sense of urgency here.
But all I'm saying
is, whether or not you feel it immediately,
how in any way does anything I've said suggest to you I don't agree with that 100%? What did I say? I want to hear what I said.
I want to hear what you didn't say. I didn't hear the visceral response of those people who say, look, my Judaism is the very essence of my being, and it is what ties me to the Jewish state.
No. Whether you can stand at the Western Wall should not be the way in which you are tied to the state of Israel.
My Judaism, I didn't say anything about the Western Wall, my Judaism.
But you can go to Israel and practice any Judaism you want.
When leaders of the Jewish state make public declarations dismissing the form of Judaism that I practice every day of my life.
It infuriates me.
It's infuriating.
It infuriates
it's
me.
It's insulting, and
it
it's
infuriates
contrary
me.
To the principles of Zionism.
100%. All I'm saying is that it has to change from within. And in the meantime, I am only saying it, in the meantime, I don't think any American Jew should take it to mean that they're not embraced by the state of Israel in a broader sense. This is a narrow, narrow sense.
Yeah, and I think that's where what I would call second misinterpretation. None of us are suggesting that if you as an American Jew cannot get married in the state of Israel, therefore you should distance yourself from Israel.
Right.
No one is taking that position
at all.
Oh,
don't say that.
Nobody around this table.
Right. But that's, I'm not speaking.
That's what Mark's worried about. No one that I know of in the Reform rabbinet.
Oh, okay. Well,
I don't know everyone in the Reform rabbinet. I will send you names.
Okay,
but people that I know, committed Jews, will not take the position of using the issue of religious pluralism as a lever.
Okay, and by the way, but if it were true, if I could show you that it's being done today, people are arguing that if Israel does not change this area of its life, you as an American Jew should distance yourself. Would that bother you?
Absolutely. But I'm saying something else is happening at the same time, which I think the interpretation and spin you give it does it an injustice. We are engaged in, all of us in one form or another, engaged in the enterprise of trying to bring American Jews closer to Israel.
Absolutely.
Trying to cement ties.
Absolutely.
The reality on the ground, whether by intent or not, the reality on the ground serves as a wedge, as a dividing line.
Absolutely.
In that context, my fear about where this is going is you have an Israeli society that has religiously polarized itself. Some, perhaps even a majority, don't care. The ones who do care are the ones who want to either preserve the status quo or make it even stronger. Talk about the Western Wall. The data here is fascinating. I think it was the AJC poll, together with the Jerusalem Post, asked about how important is the Western Wall to you as an issue. Something like 11% of Israelis, actually, I'm sorry, it was the Pew study, 11% of Israelis said it was important. What does that mean? 3% of secular Israelis thought it was important, whereas a much larger percentage of Orthodox Israelis thought it was important. In other words, the dilemma here is that of an Israeli society that is religiously polarized. That religious polarization in and of itself distances many American Jews who otherwise might be brought closer. So in that sense, it's not a matter of prescribing an advocacy tactic of saying either do it our way or our people are going to distance themselves. It's rather a strong warning that what's happening on the ground, precisely as we're trying to mount a counter-assimilatory battle, of which Israel is a very important part of it, but we can't mount that battle when the signals coming out of Israel is that your Judaism is a second-rate Judaism. It's not one that we're prepared to grant an equal level playing field to. Compounded to that, and here is, I think, somewhat the Kafkaesque of the entire thing, is that you have responsible Israeli politicians and rabbis making all sorts of irresponsible statements that no public official should ever be caught doing, but not suffering any penalty for it. Now, in that sense, I have a lot of fears about the Israel diaspora relationship as being polarized and alienated by things happening in Israel over which we seem to have no control. Therefore, we have to raise our voice.
Okay.
Very last point.
Goes back one at a time.
Okay. Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
So, again, I don't know what you heard me say that makes you think you and I have a difference of opinion. I agree with everything you say. I want Israel to change. The only point I'm making is that change has to come from within Israel. It doesn't mean we shouldn't be lobbying. We should be lobbying. I'm glad there is an Eric. I'm glad that there is a Reform movement and a conservative movement, a Reconstructionist movement, that are arguing for religious Jewish pluralism in Israel. I would like to be able to stand with my wife at the Western Wall. I don't disagree. And not only that, I am enraged with some of the things that come out of Israel that you have just identified. The only difference I have is that as the two of you speak, you seem to be much more tolerant of a Jew who says, well, if they aren't going to accept my rabbi, if I can't stand with my wife at the Western Wall, if there's not Jewish pluralism, then Israel isn't my place.
You didn't say that.
Yes, you did. Yeah. That's the only thing that bothers me. That's the difference of emphasis. And by the way, you said unequivocally that you don't want any Jew to feel that way. But you are not. Your position is not universally held. And what I am saying is I want the Jewish community to be as committed to the notion of encouraging Israelis to adopt a pluralistic mindset, while at the same time encouraging non-Orthodox American Jewry to never use this as a reason to distance themselves or feel that Israel isn't theirs or that somehow Israel is treating them as second-class Jews. When you and I go to Israel, you and I are not treated as second-class Jews. And you're not treated as a second-class Jew, even though if you were a rabbi, you would not be allowed to be a Masada or Kedushin. You're not treated as second-class, and you're not treated as second. That's my only point. It's a matter of how is the... I am very upset that the compromise that was worked out fell apart. I think it's a bad... It is one of the unfortunate, sad things that happened in 2016. All I want is, I want everybody who talks about this to at the same time say what you said. You never let it get in the way of your commitment to the State of Israel. And what you're saying is, yeah, you're worried that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Well, Steve Bayme should be saying to everybody, it shouldn't happen. And if it does happen, it's not Israel's fault, it's your fault. That's all I'm saying.
I can accept.
Okay.
I think you also, though... you're underestimating the potential, not tomorrow, not 2017, not in the next 10, 15 years, but over the course of time, as the Orthodox parties become more significant, assuming no electoral reform takes place, as the demographics become more significant, the potential of Israel transforming itself into a society that American Jewry simply will not be able to identify with, I think that potential is there. Hopefully it will never come to pass. But certainly, you know, one of the reasons it may never come to pass is precisely because enough of us do need to keep on saying, this is not a vision of Israel that I can identify with.
Okay. You and I are in Israel often. We know so many Israelis. They're not representing what you're afraid of. Most Israelis are not going to buy into an Orthodox view of Judaism that will make you and me, feel alienated.
The vast
majority of Israelis aren't there, will never be there. If anything, the problem is they're not Jewish enough. But it's not going to be all of a sudden non-Orthodox Jews are going to go to Israel and feel that they're in some kind of, you know, ultra-Orthodox hell. I don't want you saying that. Because it suggests that you think that it is on the horizon or that a very serious setback, it's a serious setback, this loss of the compromise. However, is the heralding of something horrific happening to the religious character of the State of Israel? I believe the parliamentary system has to be changed.
But look, what's happening? I mean, you said they won't be Jewish enough. In other words, there is a very sad reality that perhaps, that affects not us, that Israelis. Look, between 20 and 25% of Israelis today are not married by the rabbi, which is the only way to be legally married in Israel. Now, that's an extraordinary situation. It's Israel is the only enlightened democratic country in the world, you're an expert here, if I've got this wrong, you'll let me know, where a quarter of a million people are literally unable to be married in their own country.
Yes.
So this is simply an unacceptable situation.
Yes.
In any democratic state, and surely in a Jewish state, which is founded on principles of enlightenment.
How do you explain that something unacceptable exists in Israel? And by the way, it didn't start yesterday. It's been true for years. How is something that you and I find unacceptable is not unacceptable to the vast majority of Israelis?
Well, first of all, because things have gotten worse, as I said, in the last couple of decades, that a moderate rabbinate that found a way to deal with problems stopped for a whole variety of reasons doing that. And second of all, the cowardliness of Israel's politicians.
The Israeli people would stand up and demand it if they felt the way you did.
There are a lot of things that are happening. Perhaps that's true. I want to suggest Israel has particularly cowardly politicians when it comes to religious issues. Every now and again, you see, streaks of courage that break through. Look, in 2013, you had a government that was elected that took some modest steps, potentially significant steps, in three or four areas related to religious pluralism, mostly within the Orthodox realm. In other words, they didn't do any great favors for the reform, but at least they made Israeli Orthodoxy more moderate than it had become when it came to conversion and so forth. 2 years later, the same politicians voting on the same issues simply turned around and changed their minds. I want to suggest to you that there are political ways where braver politicians could find a way to deal with this problem. And unfortunately, Israel does not have a people, does not have leaders with that kind of courage at the moment.
Okay. By the way, I also experience it as bravery and courage. They would, of course, say that they're just being politicians who are being practical and pragmatic. And if there was enough of a public will, they would be protected by the public will and things would change. I want the same thing you want. The issue for me is I will not let it affect how I or people I know, or I'm a rabbi with a congregation of his own, I will not allow my congregation to use this as a wedge issue between us and the state of Israel. And I want to say over and over again, the Israeli people have to make this happen. If they don't, the politicians reflect who the you always get who you deserve. This is who they deserve. By the way, the three of us have been talking. What are you thinking as you in listening to this?
I agree with you completely. I feel, you know, it's not only in religious regarding religious issues, but people like to say, well, I'd be more supportive of Israel if only Israel were more like the way that I wanted, fill in the blank. And in Judaism, we say, you know, ahava tluya bedavar, that there's love. If there's if you love something because of some of a condition that exists, batel hadavar, batel ahava, but this condition goes away for some reason, then the love is no longer in existence. I think that's really not the kind of relationship you want to have with Israel, so I agree with you totally. Maybe Israel is not exactly the way that I wish she would be because of X. Nevertheless, I love Israel. I love Israel because she is my homeland and I love her. And that's, I think, that's, I agree with you. That's the attitude we should have.
I'm reminded of an essay I wrote a few months ago in the Times of Israel about two academic, American academics, women, who wrote a kind of manifesto saying that they had renounced their connection to synagogues, anything that could be possibly supportive of Israel. They're out. And I wrote what I call this, I termed this moral narcissism, which is, you see this very much on the progressive left, this idea that Israel owes them an apology for not reaching a level of perfection according to their own sense of moral superiority, as if to say, you know, I loved you, Israel, always, but now I can no longer love you, as if this is an obligation of Israel to placate American Jews to be the Israel that they want it to be. And I was also reminded of how consistent you were in these last 2 hours, because when I said something like, you know, Israel should always be aware of how its quarrels are being perceived in the outside world, you jumped back and said, yes, but please, let's not call this what it's not, right? This is hardly Sharia law. You know, this is a very small debate that even among Israelis is something that they can tolerate. And if they couldn't tolerate, as you're saying to Eric, they would do something about it. It's not intolerable to them. It's intolerable to some members of the Reform Synagogue movement here in the United States. And I think that's a cautionary term that you've been using throughout the last 2 hours. Let's not overinflate this and turn it into something that it's not. But I do think it's interesting. I reviewed a book for the Washington Post. It's a terrible book, so I don't want to invoke the name of the book. But basically taking the position that American Jews, that Israel is losing American Jewry, that they're lost, and that the only people that will support Israel at some point will be just the Orthodox. On the other hand, the Orthodox Jews are the only ones that are growing in the United States in terms of their Jewish affiliation at this point. But you know, there is this sense of divide that Steve was pointing about, and that we should be aware of this divide between the religious and the non-religious, and I think that's...
Our love for Israel is unconditional, but it's not uncritical. And that's what we need to remember.
Mm-hmm. Well said.
Can I just ask, though, accepting everything you said and your prescriptions I fully identify with. But in terms of the normative description, in terms of what's happening on the ground, if you hypothesize 20, 25 years down the road, the potential of an Orthodox demographic majority, you know, simply in terms of birth rate issues, natality. So you're looking at Israel, say, the year 2050, you wake up one morning, and there's no need for a coalition government. You have one party that's commanded a majority of the votes, and it's a religious party. And they then go ahead and decide what will be the laws of Israel. Can you really say with such, you know, conviction that it will never become anything approaching the kind of state? Other models of those states exist elsewhere, especially in that region of the world. But can you say really with such conviction, Israel will never approach that model of a state in which it's not, obviously, it's not Sharia
really
law.
It's a really unlikely scenario, Steve. I mean, it's such an intense democracy. So many Jews, so many opinions.
That's 2016.
No. We've been cantankerous, and we fight, and we've been opinionated and divided so many generations, from eons already, Steve. How can you envision an Israel describing?
The difference is that
we were born tribal. We remain tribal.
Haredi leadership, I'm not sure, is as divided as you make it out to be. And their vision of what this Jewish state ought to be is very different from anything we're talking about here. And the value they place upon democracy is a very limited value, a very low value. Therefore, I don't see how we can simply dismiss the possibility and say it'll never get there. In the meantime, one of the ways of deferring it, I think, is this notion of Israel as a state of the entire Jewish people. And in that entire Jewish people, there are multiplicity of views. And let not the coercive power of the state, you know, be used to impose one particular view. I certainly hope my scenario doesn't come to pass. But when you have families of 7, 8 children stacked up against families of 2 or 3 children, the figures don't lie at that point. And in that context, I worry about what kind of education they're getting. What do Haredi students today learn about non-Orthodox Israelis beyond the fact that they're sinning?
Israelis in general don't learn that much about non-Orthodox Jews. It's certainly not here in the United States. I mean, how many years have I been yelling at shlichim, any kind of shlichim who go home from the United States, teach in Israel, set up a curriculum that should be in the high schools about the American Jewish community? For years, this has not happened. They still don't understand the American Jewish mentality. They still don't understand where we're coming from or how we work or how we set up our community. And
the chances of affecting change in that sector are much greater than you're affecting change inside the Haredi sector.
I don't agree. I think that you're beginning to see changes on the ground in Israel in the Haredi sector that we're not giving enough credit for.
Yeah, they dismantled the only Haredi college.
More of them are in the army than you read about in the newspapers or you see on TV. More of them are getting into the business world and studying computers and working than you really read about in the papers there. It's changing slowly. It's beginning to dawn on many Haredi people in Israel that the system, the way that it is not going to be tenable in being able to support families and future generations. It is changing. I get invited to swearing-ins in the army of Nachal Haredi who become kfir. Kfir is a unit that chases after terrorists. It's not a desk job. They're really serious people. Nobody knows about it. The media doesn't cover it. Nobody speaks about it. And there are inroads. And it does change. It doesn't change overnight. And it doesn't change. You know, the 68 years old is still a very young country. And culture in the Middle East moves very slowly. So what's happening in Israel is really enlightening by comparison to others. I think that you have to pay attention and listen and see what's happening. And percolating up slowly in many different sectors. It's not going to stay the same. It cannot stay the same because of economics, just because of the ability of the children to make a living and the way that the world is changing in terms of technology and social media. And if we talked about before, everything. It's changing. It's not going to always stay the same. There will always be sectors that will be the same and things change. There will be a new emphasis on education, and they will not want their children to stay back in another century as time goes on. I don't believe that. I think your scenario is just too dark.
I'm glad you're so optimistic about it, so confident. I would not be so confident.
Okay.
I also want to say to you, what you describe would be a real tragedy for the Jewish people
as a whole.
But I don't want people who are not familiar with Israel to think that if you go to Israel now and you travel in 97% of the country, that you're running into Haredi Jews.
Absolutely.
And you should make sure everybody understands, at the moment there is a small pocket of Haredi Jews. And we've heard more and more that Jerusalem is becoming more and more Haredi. But if you travel to Tel Aviv, if you travel to the north, if you travel through the center of the country, there's no Haredi there.
This we have is, nothing against this, Haredi Jews.
No.
Let's be careful with our language. Talking about them as if somehow they're...
Well, no. I understand.
Good to hear that from you.
I understand. We all understand what Steve is saying. And if it became an Orthodox theocracy in the state of Israel, that would be bad for the Jewish people. At the moment, however, make sure the audience understands. You're... In the worst case, you're talking a century. There's such an infinitesimal amount of this in Israel, and that the real problem of Israel is not it's becoming Haredi. The real problem of Israel is it's becoming more and more secular, and more Jews in Israel self-identify as Israeli, not Jew, and they do not understand what you and what many Israelis do understand, but many do not, that we are one, and the state of Israel is part of something larger. And there are people who are now working very hard to create a different educational system in Israel that will teach Israelis more about what it means to be part of the world Jewish community. And there are programs when you're first drafted into the IDF, that you're taught the extent to which the IDF is a function of a larger Jewish community. That most Israelis never visit the Western Wall. Most Israelis never visit Jerusalem. But when I found that out, it was impossible. How could a Jew live in Israel and not go to the Jerusalem and not go to the Western Wall? The majority of Israelis have never been to Jerusalem and never been to the Western Wall. So I just want to put this in perspective for viewers who may hear what you're saying, and they would be as horrified as I would. But it's not anywhere in the near future, and I don't believe it'll ever happen.
Fair enough.
Can we agree that anybody who's watching this discussion on television right now, if they go to visit Israel, even if they're Reform, conservative, secular, in the vast majority, there is almost no moment of their visit to Israel where this will impact them. Can we agree on that?
By and large, it's only true unless they want to.
By and large?
Well, if they want to take a walk to Meir Shearim, they're going to have to make their accommodations to it. I mean, that's a reality.
In other words, if they want to go as a tourist to see an attraction of Orthodox Jewry, yes, they'll be going through an Orthodox section of town. But in general.
You're right, Mark.
Okay.
Mark, you're right.
Okay. And I just want the audience to understand that if you go to Israel, you will not be impacted harshly. Okay, we're nearing the end. We've talked about Trump, and we've talked about Jewish pluralism, which I happen to think was the next most important issue. Obviously, I thought Wiesel's passing was also momentous, and I wished it never happened. Okay, is there any other issue any of you would want to bring up in the time remaining? And is there, I was reflecting on the fact that so often when Jews talk about their year, they're talking about things that were upsetting. Are there things at all that pleased you about 2016 that you would want to mention, Betty?
Yes, I have two.
Okay.
Okay, in the context of something upsetting but something uplifting, What's going on in Syria is still going on. It's pretty terrible. There is spillover in the sense into Israel in the sense that refugees, wounded, sick, are coming in. And I want to, you had met in the context of person of the year, let's say.
Yes, do you have a person of the year?
There is a person of the year, and a collective person of the year embodied in Ziv Medical Center in Tzfat, which has been helping, rescuing, and taking care of wounded Syrian refugees, and I think they deserve our kudos, and the world
That's
is
lovely.
Not recognizing this, but it should. Another one was, this is an individual, the world's oldest man, said the JTA in October, 113-year-old Yisrael Kristal, a Holocaust survivor living in Israel, celebrated his bar mitzvah. And that was just a wonderful, heartwarming story because this person, this Yisrael Kristal, missed his bar mitzvah due to World War I. His father was in the Russian army, and his mother died 3 years earlier. So this past October, 100 of his descendants, can you imagine, came to Haifa to celebrate a big birthday party
that
in bar mitzvah.
That
and
is
I thought
wonderful.
That was a wonderful story.
All right, I'll take from anybody any other nice moment or who you might nominate as person of the year.
One overarching theme throughout the year, which I think in retrospect surprises me a great deal, but it's well worth underscoring, is that Israel's diplomatic international position is stronger today than, say, 12 months ago. And here credit must be given to the Netanyahu government, that he undertook a major initiative. That initiative obviously will have mixed results, but it's had better results, I think, than anyone imagined. Every September at HAC, we host about 60 different delegations as part of the General Assembly of foreign governments, state departments of other countries. Invariably, I shouldn't say invariably, oftentimes they don't, but very many times they comment upon the fact that their relations with Israel today are actually better than they were a year ago. Mm-hmm. And again, I think that's something obviously neglected by the media. That's not a major story that's going to grab headlines, mm-hmm. but I think it's quite real in terms of solidifying Israel's position.
Okay, and at the same time, we should have mentioned this a little bit more. Talk about how you feel about the UNESCO changing the names of Jewish historical sites.
Well, this is it's outrageous, to say the least. I mean, look, the one of the things that does tie American Jews to Israel and should tie the world to Israel is that it is the land of the Bible, you know, the land of the centerpiece, if you will, of the of two of the world's major historical religions. To denude it of its Jewish base, of its Jewish foundations, symbolically, or better yet, tangibly, it may not have any real political implications. But symbolically, you know, it's a statement on the at UNESCO, not exactly the centerpiece of international morality. It's a statement that the Jewish connections to Israel are not taken seriously or not recognized. Frankly, they're akin to Arafat's final statement at Camp David in 2000, where he said, "Whoever said there was a temple on that wall, on that mount, to begin with?" Plenty of people have said it, including the New Testament, for that matter. But that kind of attack upon the Jewish connection to sites of historical interest, one could easily identify that as the anti-Judaism mm-hmm. of today.
Mm-hmm. Oh, do you have a person of the year?
I was inclined in terms of our thinking earlier. I had two. One, I guess, would be considered humorous, but is quite real. The architect of the Chicago Cubs and the Boston Red Sox, and a man of enormous Judaic ancestry, certainly in terms of his father and his grandfather.
Tactfully put,
right, exactly. But frankly, I think he gratified the hearts of many of us, many long-suffering Red Sox and Cub fans, and due credit needs to be given.
You still haven't mentioned his name.
Yeah, Theo Epstein.
Theo Epstein, absolutely.
Theo Epstein.
Theo Epstein, yeah. The other side of it, obviously, is the other coin, and that is that, yes, the loss of Elie Wiesel is felt deeply. Here was the man who, in many ways, was the Jewish spokesman for a generation.
Well, I'm so glad you said that. I was saying to myself, I would have made him man of the year. It's strange to make somebody who died the man of the year, but I felt that the overarching figure in terms of what happened in 2016, given the fact that nobody else, I felt, did something so spectacular, I was going to give it to Elie Wiesel too, and I feel I'm glad you did, and I agree with you 100%. First of all, any comment on anything you've heard or otherwise? Is there something that made you happy at all in 2016? You're like, you think we should also, we have a reason to celebrate? And who is your person of the year?
I'll give you my person of the year.
Good.
You'd never guess.
No.
Benny Biggin.
I am shocked. Why? Because, well, you should identify him first.
Benny Biggin is the son of Menachem Biggin.
Yeah.
He's a geologist. He's been in and out of the Knesset, somebody who sees himself as carrying on his father's legacy in the best sense, somebody with whom I disagree on most issues. But as Israel, I mean, on the one hand, we have all kinds of people who say, you know, settlements are not the issue, and yet Israel seems to be somehow continually obsessed with settlements. And so right now, as legislation is being presented, and we don't have to go into all the details, to defy the Israeli Supreme Court, also, always my heroes, who have stood for human rights under all circumstances, despite a terrible pressure. And in order to overcome the Supreme Court, there are elements of the Prime Minister's party and other parties. They're trying to pass legislation that would cross a red line that the Supreme Court has laid down. Now, by and large, the Supreme Court doesn't get overly involved in all kinds of issues of territories and settlement. I mean, that's not commonly understood. That, in fact, is the case. But in one area, they're very tough, and they say, we're not going to steal land from the Palestinians. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If somebody owns this land, a Palestinian, we cannot take it for them to build a Jewish settlement. And now there are attempts legislatively to set that aside and talk in terms of, well, it will be okay and we'll offer compensation and so on. There are different versions of the bill. Many of these bills come from the Likud party, which is Begin's party. And Benny Begin, his son, who was brought into the government by Netanyahu and didn't particularly have interest in serving this time around, has said absolutely not. He said, I will oppose any legislation that says it will be all right for us to establish settlements, which by and large he approves of, let me make that clear, which are going to rest on stolen Palestinian land. And then it's an affront to my father, it's an affront to my party, it's an affront to Zionism, it's an affront to the values that we stand for here. He has actually been suspended from his party for a short period of time, hasn't been able to, you know, participate in committee meetings and so on and so forth. And he has asserted principles in the face of tremendous pressure from those who would subvert Zionism. He hasn't gotten appropriate credit and appropriate recognition, and I see him as a real hero.
That is wonderful. And now on JBS, he is your person of the year.
Yes.
He's one of the four people of the year. Okay. So you're going to wrap it up for us. Anything you want to say good about 2016, and who's your person of the year?
Well, two fine moments for the Jewish people, certainly for Israel, is not a very widely known story was that Danny Danon, the UN, Israel's ambassador to the United Nations, was elected as the chairman of Committee 6 in the UN, which is the law committee. No Israeli ambassador to the UN has ever chaired a committee. That's an astounding achievement and a political achievement. It took many years of lobbying, and I think Ron Prasor was also responsible for sort of building. Now, that doesn't change the fact that all the human rights condemnations that are passed resolutions in the UN still are against Israel. It's a process, but this is something that we have not seen before. And I think also the visual photo op of Netanyahu and other leaders with African leaders. We saw this year, you know, for all of the condemnation of Israel, you're starting to see new relations. Some of it, I think, was probably Netanyahu would say was become necessary because of a sort of a division or distance with the United States, that Israel was reaching out more broadly, more widely. And again, I'm not sure of its effect, its sum total effect, but as a visual spectacle, it's fascinating to see that Israel, on one hand being condemned, on the other hand you're seeing its prime minister standing next to world leaders around the world with a spirit of cooperation and the spirit of Israel's startup initiative. Everyone sees the value of having business dealings and diplomatic relations with Israel.
Before you give me your personal year, this reminds, first of all, what Thane says really echoes your point earlier about the standing of Israel in the United Nations. But also, you and I were at an event in Washington, co-sponsored by the Conference of Presidents and the Embassy of
Azerbaijan.
And it was celebrating all the, basically, Islamic countries, Muslim countries, that helped Israel fight the forest fires. We didn't mention the forest fires in either program.
We should have, yeah.
And they were a major event in 2016, and they were, my understanding is they were caused by terrorists who were trying to destroy Israeli forests. And there was this international assistance given to Israel by many Muslim countries.
Tunisia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan.
And the Palestinians.
And the Palestinians.
And we were at an event where it was a Hanukkah party in which every one of the ambassadors received a small menorah from the Conference of Presidents in gratitude for their work. And at the end, there's this montage of all of these ambassadors.
13, I counted.
Standing together. And there was something very moving about
that.
Very moving. And it sort of reflects what you're saying.
You're seeing more and more of that,
yes,
international cooperation.
And the standing of Israel, which you talked about, mm-hmm. has evolved. And maybe 2016 is a watershed in that regard.
Should know, but in terms of Ambassador Danone, twice this year, in July and now again in December, he took 11 or 12 UN ambassadors on a trip to Israel, first under AJC auspices. And obviously, these people have very different views about many different policy issues, but their willingness to travel under his leadership, you know, to Israel, study all the issues, that speaks very well for Israeli diplomacy.
Last night, the UN ambassador from Mexico, who just came back from that last trip, spoke beautifully at the Hanukkah party. And I thought it was really wonderful. He talked about how impressed he was with what he saw in Israel. And Mexico does not have a very good voting record regarding Israel in the United Nations. So this was really very important. Mm-hmm.
It's not like we've touched everything. You're going to give us your personal year. And incidentally, we have no time to really discuss it. But I will ask you, did the ADL flap over Jonathan Greenblatt, and I'm not asking you an institutional question, but did it bother you in terms of the divide that seems to be growing in the Jewish world? And Jonathan Greenblatt, who was the new national director of ADL, was criticized very, very strongly for taking stands that seemed to be embracing of J Street, Black Lives Matter. He, for a period of time, ADL supported Keith Ellison. Greenblatt was in a celebrated editorial tiff with Izzy Liebler. But in general, your comment on it?
Divisiveness is a negative. Divisiveness is something that will hurt us as a people. In terms of long-term trends, the pro-Israel consensus in the community, again, don't blame this on Greenblatt per se, and don't personalize it. It's been going on for quite some time, but it's exploding as we speak.
Okay. Any comment on it?
I like Greenblatt. I think he's done a good job. I've disagreed with him on some specific issues. I think he's moved the organization slightly towards the center, and I think that's offended a lot of people who expected different things from ADL. But I think he deserves a lot of credit for good work.
Okay. Any comment on it?
I agree with Steve on the divisiveness in the community. I think it makes us very vulnerable, and I hope we can take some measures in 2017 to stop it.
Okay. And your comment on it?
I thought the one piece of that we didn't mention was Greenblatt's essay in Foreign Affairs, challenging Israel's position on settlement negotiations. The fact that a sitting head of a Jewish American institution would actually write an essay challenging and attacking the policies taken by an Israeli prime minister was unprecedented. I thought of all the things that were done, I thought that was the most interesting and the most provocative.
Mm-hmm. Okay, who's your person of the year?
Jared Kushner.
Very, explain why.
I just think that he was at cornerstone, the centerpiece of the most astonishing story of the year. And this was a campaign that should have never happened by many people's estimation. It should have been sabotaged at numbers of occasions. No one expected Trump to survive anything. And then he pulls this off at the end. And again, Kushner's Jewish identity was always invoked. It was never hidden. It was always part of the story. And even the point that you focused on in the first half, the first hour, the segment, was, yes, and he was probably responsible for David Friedman. And if that's the case, in terms of the impact on the Jewish world, this very young man who's had no political experience at all somehow wound up at the biggest story and at the very center, cornerstone of the biggest story.
Any comment on Kushner?
Something I alluded to earlier is that I think at the end of our last hour together, I said, I don't think that the Trump administration will consciously, overtly move in directions that would be regarded as anti-Jewish or hurtful to Israel. I think that's reflected in the fact that he has gone out of his way to appoint some very high-profile Jews. Jared Kushner obviously is the most clearly identified. Their presence, regardless of their particular policies and directions, again, many of which I might agree with, many of which I might disagree with, but their presence really is a safeguard that elements that might otherwise be supporting Trump or are supporting Trump and that are part of his base, those elements, if they were to call for specific actions hurtful to Jews or to Israel, would be guarded against. It's a safeguard, if you will.
How can I thank the four of you enough? This is just so wonderful of you. And, you know, you give our audience an opportunity to hear thinking and ideas that I'm sure will challenge them and make them think. And it gives us a wonderful way of looking back at a year that's coming to a close in the Jewish world. So I thank you so very much. All four of you are just spectacular. And that you give me this kind of time is wonderful. Thank you.
Great
thank
to be
you,
with
Mark.
You.
Great to be thank with you. You. Wonderful moderator.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, sweetheart. Thank you, thank you. And that's our year-end review for 2016. We hope you've enjoyed hearing the thoughts and insights of Steve Bayme, Eric Yoffie, Betty Ehrenberg, and Thane Rosenbaum. Of course, as always, I'd love to hear your thoughts or what you think were the most important Jewish events of 2016 or anything you'd like to add to the discussion on these two editions of L'Chaim, to anything, again, discussed on the L'Chaim roundtables. Anything else you can think of that's important for 2016, please email me, write me, post on our Facebook page, or tweet me. I look forward to hearing from many of you. And as we close 2016, all of us here at the Round Table, all of us who bring you JBS, wish every one of you a most lovely end to calendar year 2016 and a year of health and joy in 2017. And may it be a year of peace for us, for all the people of Israel, and for women, children, and men everywhere. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
Pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.